So thanks so much. I was just saying to someone that I really think I'm coming to this lecture, I mean public lecture, I didn't actually think it was going to be a public lecture, even by terminology, because I see myself as so much as a novice in this entire field. Truthfully speaking, I know I can see Usha raising her eyebrows and in sarcasm, but it's not, I truthfully do not actually know enough in many areas, but I do know about many areas of social justice and its attempt to interact with this growing internet world. And it's not just the internet world, so I'll try and take you through in this next half an hour or so a journey and try and look at some of the lessons in that journey where I've had a privilege of being part of a set of people who actually have very, very powerful, very, very wonderful developed ideas about information, technology, communication, social justice, change, democracy, maybe in different language and maybe in different modes. So part of what I'll talk about is these different modes. So part of what the discussion will be or the dialogue will be on where they reached before they reached the internet, or where they are outside of the internet, but which has a lot of relevance also to the internet as well. I think one of the things that we, first things that we learned, I went in 1987 along with my two far better equipped colleagues, Aruna and Shankar, to a village, small village in Rajasthan called Devdungri. And we went to fight for the rights of the poor, to work for an organization that would fight for the rights of the poor people of that area. And it was the poor. Wherever I go now, I'm even today in today when we were driving here, I'm quickly labeled or identified as an RTI activist. I don't know whether I am that at all in some ways. And the reason I don't know whether I'm that any more than any other citizen is because the people who raised the issues that they did raise and the people who gave birth to the Right to Information campaign certainly did not give birth to a thinking about right to information. Neither that terminology nor that means by which even we in the rest of our country understand right to information. They gave birth to a set of demands which they saw as their birthright. And that birthright was their birthright to information. They didn't term it as so, but they said that this information belongs to us. And the reason that they had to come to that particular thing, and I'll just briefly, we started off with several, in 1987 when we went, there were several years of drought, there was abysmal poverty and close to destitution of the kind that I haven't seen subsequently, because it was several years of drought and things have in some ways also changed in terms of access. And people were asking for work, and when they got work, they were not getting the full wage. And it was out of that demand of social justice in a sense, that they said, why are we not getting their wage and our wage? And the answer was, oh, the poor do not work. So they said, where do we not work? And through that whole interaction, they said, no, that's in the records. And a person called Mohanji, very early, actually in about 1989, said to us in a discussion, there were others thinking along those lines, that until we get those records out, we will never be able to identify that we are the ones telling the truth and they are the ones telling lies, because those records govern us. There was some, don't just administer us, they govern us. So this idea of two kinds of information, they said, we have information, but our information is different from their information. And until we can juxtapose the two, we cannot actually prove who are the liars and who's telling the truth and what the reality is or what the truth is. So people have always had, and it was again, I'll go back to Mohanji's even earlier set of songs. Mohanji had never been to school. Mohanji was one of our greatest RTI activists. He died last year. And Mohanji wrote a song. Wrote means he didn't write because he couldn't write. But composed a song which said, Raj Choron Ka. This was in 1988, the first song that we heard. He was a Dalit, never been to school. He was about 50 at that time. So it said, Raj Choron Ka, Jamana Bhaya Rishwat Khoron Ka, Raj Choron Ka. Pehle wale chor janglon mein rehte the, aaj kal ke chor banglon mein rehte hain, Raj Choron Ka. Then it went on, pehle wale chor bandukon se lootte the, aaj kal ke chor kalmon se lootte hain, Raj Choron Ka. Which was, to my mind, looking back on it, so much of an indication of why and where people were looking towards those people who hadn't gone to school, who couldn't read a record like that, understood how much that record and that information system was being used to exploit them and as a tool of exploitation, and how much therefore that had to be dealt with. And similarly, in that same song, he said, Pehle wale chor janglon mein lootte the, aaj kal ke chor bazaar mein lootte hain, Raj Choron Ka. Which again, in those very early days, later battles, and the ideas of where the centers of those battles would be, come back, because it's a song we sang so many times and therefore one could remember, otherwise we wouldn't even remember. So this collective history of remembering through various means, which is what so much of information systems is, became very interesting when we started getting access to records, and the records and counter records. Because first we got access not legally but through friends, or through not so good friends, through even stealing in a sense, where we would copy down by hand by someone who would just give us and show us a record. And the first set of Jan Sunwais that we did, when we placed those records in the public domain, firstly brought out the drama of this whole information system as it is. Because it was incredible, those records which had been used to say, oh, you can't get wages, had hundreds of people's names who were dead, who didn't exist, the names of cats and dogs in the village, the names of people taken from a voting list. And there were buildings that did not exist that were recorded there. And when that was placed in the public domain, the drama of that. But even more dramatic was when officialdom said, oh, but how can you prove that there were only so many bags of cement? You're saying that there were only 33 bags of cement used, and the records show there were 330. How do you say 33? Our engineer has measured and says there's 330. So someone got up there and said, every old bag of cement I took from here and I sold for 2 rupees each, and I have my record that there were 33 bags, because shuru se leke ant tak maine hi beche wo sare bags, jo khali bag the, 2-2 rupaye mujhe mila, 66 rupaye mujhe mila. I got those. So that were his records. Like the Jain diaries, every single mystery maintains a little scrubby diary. And all those diaries came tumbling out during those public hearings, which gave an exact picture of how many bags of cement and how much steel and how much, at what rate, from where it came, on what date it came, meticulously maintained, better maintained than those Angrezon wale records which were there officially. So this placing of one set of records against the other, but it gets even more interesting. That chalo, these are still systems of record maintenance in a sense. But there was, and actually I'll tell you another story. There's a woman who's a very good friend of Aruna's called Bila. And she again has never been to school. And when she would talk about, in so-and-so year, 22 years ago, I got this rate at this famine work site doing this many days of work, people would question her and say, how do you remember? It's impossible for you to remember. We can't remember. And she used to say, hamara to akal hai, aap logon ka keval nakal hai. because all you can do is copy down. We actually have to remember, and we do remember, and there is truth behind that remembering, and there is that information system and part of that information system where that akal is used in a particular way, and it's used in multiple ways. And I'm going all into all this in a little bit of depth because these are things I remember from here and there, but it goes to show how powerful those systems are for people themselves. There was a woman called Gopi in about the 5th or 6th public hearing in a place called Janavat. Janavat became a famous or infamous public hearing because huge fraud was discovered. About 44 works that did not exist in that panchayat suddenly emerged when painting took place on the wall, and people, many, many things in the, happened in that. But a very interesting thing happened when the team that was doing the public hearing was going around from house to house. They went to Gopi's house, like every other house, to ask, did you go to work? And they happened to go into Gopi's, was a very, very poor kacha house. And she was talking about going to work and not getting her wages. And then she took them to near her chula. And near the chula was a little patch, half the size, quarter of the size of this board, where there were soot marks. There were 168 soot marks. So what she had done is every time she and her husband went to work, for every day's hajri, they marked it on the wall. Now that was 4 years old. Her husband had died in the interim. She had nipoed her house many times, but that particular patch she kept because that was her record of unpaid wages. And that was where she maintained it and kept it. And proof of it, and every single day was there, not a day more and not a day less. The tragedy to me, I often think of that, is that in our public hearings, hundreds and thousands of people have been paid back their wages, and lakhs have been paid back, and all kinds of things have happened. Gopi also died and we didn't manage to get her wages paid. But in that whole scenario and her faith in managing to fight for social justice based on the proof of those dots lies actually our interaction with this whole information system. To my mind, it's that tenacity that, no, what is the reality is what we will record. We will record it in our own ways. We will make sure that that record emerges and that record is heard. And that's the story of the Right to Information campaign. That's why it is so powerful in this country, to my mind, and less powerful elsewhere, because people actually defined it the way that they wanted to. And people brought it up not as some freedom of expression issue at all, but as an issue of fighting for social justice, using information and using truth as a basis of fighting for social justice. So in this fight, what are the things that suddenly emerged, apart from the Jain diary type diaries or these dots on the wall or people's own knowledge and information or people's... There is a woman who is hounding me just now, and she's one of the early people who refused to take less than the minimum wage. And it's now over 20 years, and that muster roll where she has still not received her minimum wage, and that's again, like Gopi, is one of those early battles. We've won later battles, but that is a battle we not won. Even at 83 today, she can tell me the dates of those works. She can tell me who was on that work site. She can tell me, and she tells me, it's not that she can tell me, she tells me every day, and she tells me, duniya bhar mein ghoomte firte ho, hamara ek kaam aaj tak nahi kiya hai. तो ये बंद कर दो, काम कर रहे हो लेकिन दुनिया का काम बंद करो, मेरा तो पैसा तो दिलाओ, मैं लड़ी नहीं है, मेरा और मेरे साथी लोगों का. एंड देयर इज नो चांस दैट एनीवन कैन टेल हर. द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन हैज बीन ट्राइंग टू निगोशिएट, थोड़ा सा कम ले लो. शी नोज एग्जैक्टली हाउ मच ईच वन शुड गेट फॉर एग्जैक्टली हाउ मेनी डेज, एंड शी हैज आल्सो नेवर बीन टू स्कूल. सो इट इज दैट टेनेसिटी एंड दैट बैटल एंड दैट पावर फॉर जस्टिस. इज एक्चुअली शी डजंट नीड द मनी, शी नीड्स दैट डिग्निटी, शी नीड्स दैट जस्टिस, एंड इट्स दैट बैटल फॉर जस्टिस दैट इज far more important, and that's define the right to information campaign, because almost nobody who fought long days, 40 days on Dharna, 54 days on Dharna, going all across the state, almost nobody was fighting for anything personal. There was nothing they were going to get out of it that would change their own personal economic lives at all. They were really fighting for some much larger idea of a better, a more just society, a better world, and they were fighting knowing the power of information. So that's why I've gone into that, and in that they used all kinds of things which I've learned. I mean, my friend and colleague Shankar is a fabulous communicator, and often in these things, these terms are also interesting. Information, ICT, information communication technology. Suddenly it's become one computer. Information is so many things. Communication is so many things. And Shankar's storytelling is so much more powerful as communication than any form of communication that I can otherwise think of. The mic and the power of the mic, and that as a technology, a communication technology for enhancing. If the computer enhances, so does the mic enhance, and so powerful and so much of a difference it makes. A chota mic, a bada mic, how you use that mic, how you use the mic with your voice, how you use the parcha, the traditional parcha, which I think since the independence movement has been the one through every kind of political battle has been the one that's been used, and how powerful that is, even amongst communities jo padhe likhe nahi hai, the communication of that. Later on I'll talk briefly about the wall and this idea of how you democratize, and all these are issues of democratizing information, because how do you include everyone possible? If you're communicating, your idea is to reach everyone and everywhere, and if there are divides, you overcome those divides or you find other ways of overcoming those divides. The public hearing, which has been for us a fantastic education of multiple forms of democratic communication and participatory democracy, the Jan Sunwai, because it was basically meant as a Sunwai, just to hear each other out in a particular community and the power of it. And therefore, finally, in that Jan Sunwai also, the understanding that we have our information systems, but we have to juxtapose them with these official ones, and we have to be able to win that battle. We know who is what is the truth, but we have to find a mode where we can win that battle, and that's where that Jan Sunwai became so powerful, because it was a way, a democratic platform in saying, you come and you place your information, and we'll come and place our information. And let the information speak for itself. And let all of us testify in an open platform. You say all you want to say, all you have to say. We will also say all we have to say. And at the end of that, let us see where the truth really lies. And that Jan Sunwai also was forged, planned, shaped by ordinary people understanding how that democratic mode needed to be built. It's a very complex thing to sit for 7 hours, to look at a particular issue or look at a set of issues, to look at records in a very technical fashion. You're suddenly looking at measurement books, you're looking at all the official records that you and I, like a doctor's parchi, cannot understand. But people not only understand it, they counter it, not only counter it, they finally say, let's leave your records and let's go see the real thing. And therefore, the proximity to the real thing, or your capacity to bring the real in, again has something to do, I think, to me, in this internet world where we suddenly think that the virtual can replace the real. And actually somewhere the real has to be kept, we have to keep bringing it back, and that ordinary communities who have to deal with real issues of hunger, of health, of starvation, of whatever else, certainly cannot live in a virtual world. So, yeah, that was the past, but gradually around the mid-90s, we started encountering the digital world, because it wasn't so much there at all. It wasn't even there in our records till about the mid-90s and late 90s. And in the interaction with that digital world, there was an understanding that I think some of the things that one has heard, that digitizing has certainly allowed much more the marketing of information, much more the appropriation of information, and much more building of this virtual kind of world where one set of people really can feel that much of the world can exist within just that screen. But another set of people who are fighting for social justice, who need to fight for social justice, need a world outside that, but they have to also interact with it. So often someone has said that today's children live on three screens, the computer screen, the mobile screen, and the TV screen. And that can only be children of a certain class. Children of another class have to go to a classroom, have to deal with health, have to deal most importantly with food, and have to deal with many, many issues outside these three screens. And in that dealing with that outside world, they have to also now interact with the wonder of these three screens, because it's also not a question of rejecting these three screens. And I'll tell you a story a little bit before I get into this. Of a person called Sanjay Sani. And it's a very interesting, it's a big jump, but I'll come to that story, because I think it typifies to me what happened in the public hearings. This whole battle began, and I've often talked about this, so excuse me those who've heard it before, but to me the defining of information by people through their slogans was again something really, really powerful. So jab first people said, you know, what, when we raised issues of corruption or raised issues of injustice, they used to say, ye sarkari paisa hai, jalne do. But gradually when they realized that in those records was my money, because I wasn't getting my wages because of those records, it became mera paisa, not sarkari paisa. And then it became, when they realized everyone was not getting their money, it became hamara paisa. And the first slogan that emerged, which is such a powerful slogan, hamara paisa, hamara hisab, in four words sums up, to my mind, the democratizing of the right to information, because it lays ownership not just about over money but over records. Kyunki hisab bhi hamara hai, wo paisa bhi hamara hai. And paisa hamara hai not just in terms of accounts, but those slogans became, ye paise hamare aapke, nahi kisi ke baap ke. And then the institutions, ye panchayat hamare aapki, nahi kisi ke baap ki, ye sarkar hamare aapki, nahi kisi ke baap ki, ye desh hamare aapka, nahi kisi ke baap ka. So the building of alternative institutions is also very important. These days we have a lot of discussion about participatory democracy, but I think just this superficial touch with labels will certainly not do. We need to build those institutions, and the Jan Sunwai's journey towards public audits gave us an idea of how meticulous and difficult and complex that exercise is, but how crucial and vital it is, because you can't simply get 50 people together and call it a Jan Sunwai or call it a public audit. It won't work. And you can't simply have, okay, everyone send an SMS and this is our referendum for the day. That won't work either. And therefore, the detailing of participatory democracy brings in all these questions, I think, where, yes, there is a need for the digital mode and there is a need for all those particular things. So in fighting for this, I just now want to tell you a story. One day, like, I get many, many calls every week. I got a call from a guy who I couldn't quite understand when he was calling, and he was persistently calling. He's called today also, by the way, just now. So after 5 or 6 calls, he said, "Bhai sahab, aap meri baat sunoge ki nahi sunoge?" So I said, "Haan, sununga." He said, "Mera naam Sanjay Sani hai, main Bihar, kuch kuch kuch." Again, I gave him some Bihar number because I thought I can't understand him. And so he said, "Nahi, main Delhi mein hoon." And I happened to be in Delhi. So I said, "Haan, theek hai, दिल्ली में हो तो आ जाओ, हौसखास में हूँ, मैं भी दिल्ली में हूँ, आज हूँ, आप हौसखास में आ जाओ इस जगह। सो ही टर्न्ड अप एंड ही स्टार्टेड अ स्टोरी। ही सेड मैं मुजफ्फरपुर का रहने वाला हूँ बिहार में, और मैं यहाँ बिजली की एक दुकान, एवरीवन अंडरस्टैंड्स हिंदी, सो आई विल स्पीक इन हिंदी और शुड आई से दिस इन इंग्लिश, आई कैन, इट्स इंग्लिश, ओके। सो ही सेड आई लिव इन बिहार, I mean, I'm from this village in Muzaffarpur. I've studied up to the 7th standard and I run a bijli ka small shop. Matlab, the shop is not a shop, it's a little kiosk in Janakpuri in Delhi. And I've been here for 7-8 years. My wife is here, my children are here. And one day I went, like I go every second month to my village. I went to my village and someone said, there's great fraud in NREJ, we are writing a complaint. So I also signed that complaint. I signed that complaint and that evening the sarpanch came and shouted at me and said, I'll knock off your head. So he said, I got very upset with that. So I thought, really, there must be some truth in that complaint. So I said, we must pursue this more, and I was not used to being under the sarpanch. All those people in the village got scared, but I had become a Dilliwala. So I went back next time and found out about the complaint, and the sarpanch said, now I'm really going to knock off your head. So he said, I got even more angry. And then that sarpanch went and shouted at my wife, shouted at my parents, shouted at everyone else, got everyone else scared. It suddenly started possessing me. So he said, outside my bijli ka dukan was an internet dhaba. And I couldn't understand what this dhaba was. People would come in, come out, mostly young people. They would pay money for sitting in front of these computer screens. And what they would do, I couldn't do understand. And there was a Sardarji running that dhaba. And sometimes my tools at night, I would put in his internet dhaba. So I asked the Sardarji, what is all this that these young people are paying you money for? So he said, this is the internet. So he said, what is the internet? So he said, you can see the world in the internet. So he said, I couldn't understand that either, but I looked, peeped over people's screens, didn't look like the world, they were all looking at different things, but nevertheless, when this thing happened, that evening I went there, and when my mind was possessed with this fight with the sarpanch, and I said to the Sardarji, can I see my village? Can I see my district in this internet? So the Sardarji said, yes. So he said, show me. So he sat there. So he said, what's the name of your district? So they wrote Muzaffarpur. So he said, okay, can I see my panchayat? So he said, yes, Ratnoli. And they wrote Ratnoli. And there came the panchayat. So he said, can I see NREJ? So the Sardarji said, what is NREJ? So he said, it's an employment program. So the Sardarji wrote NREJ and up popped the NREJ website of Government of India. So he said, now I want my village in this. So somehow they bumbled along and they found their way to the social audit formats which are in the NREJ website. Not so easy to find actually, but they found their way there. And up came the names of all his neighbors on the muster rolls who had never actually gone to work, and they were there. Hundreds of days against them, hundreds of rupees against them, tens and 20, 30, 50 days against them. So he was really excited. He said, can I get copies of this? So he said, sure, you can get copies. So he took a whole bunch of copies and he went and he said, ab to sarpanch ki chutti ho gayi. But he went there and there was hangama in the village. But actually, the sarpanch just came and said, get out of here tonight. And the sarpanch told everyone that this is all lies. He's brought some records from somewhere else. Where is the proof? Where is the muster roll? This is not the muster roll. So he called me from there. From then started a story of daily calling. He said, now what do I do? He's saying, where's the muster roll? So I said, you're sitting in Muzaffarpur. What do I do? He said, he's threatening to kill me. So I said, come back. So But he turned up, he said, now what do we do? So there was an officer called Santosh Matthew, some of you may know him, who was principal secretary in Bihar, who's a great one for the internet. Lots of things will get solved through the internet. So I called Santosh and I said, there's this fantastic story just up your street. Now, you're principal secretary of this department, you have to sort it out. He heard the story and he said, send this guy to me now, not tomorrow, just now. There's no better story than this. And I'll sort that panchayat out. So Sanjay Sahni, again very excited, went with his records there. Now, I can talk about this story for the next 2 hours. I want to make a long story short. Santosh Matthew sent a team that got threatened itself and it came back. Then Santosh Matthew, we said, leave everything else aside, just give him the damn original record so that he can show it. The Gram Sevak and the Sarpanch went with the records away, and when they tried to act against them, the whole district Sarpanches went on strike. So the records were very powerful. This whole story carried on. The story has also many tragic things. The first person, so in between we told, I told Sanjay Sahni, you get an RTI application put so that you can get the original records. Let's see through the normal course how long it takes. A person called Ram Kumar Thakur filed that RTI application. Ram Kumar Thakur filed the application, didn't get the records, got half the records, started fighting that Sarpanch, had been fighting him even earlier. And about 8 months later, first he was attacked once, his brother was attacked, and he was shot finally and killed. And neither Santosh Matthew, nor Sanjay Sahni, nor the NCPRI, no Aruna and a visit to Nitish Kumar, who knows every little bit of this story, has managed to make a single arrest of a daylight killing with eyewitnesses of who shot in the daylight Ram Kumar Thakur, leave alone the other parts of that corruption. So, I mean, I tell this story because it's a very, very powerful story. There are other good sides to it. Sanjay Sahni is a hero in about 40 panchayats in that area. NREGA that did not run at all is running like nowhere else in Bihar. I mean, there are hundreds of people at work. We decided to switch, that leave the corruption case for a while, just get people at work. And we told Santosh, at least that can you do, and that he did. He did deliver in terms of work. But I'm saying it because the Sanjay Sahnis of this world are out there trying to get to the internet. But his internet interaction was that much. The real fight is many, many other multiple things that he's at day in and day out. That much that he could access was accessible because actually that social audit format also came out of a debate where we were saying that your management information system is of no use to people. What we need is a Janta information system within that, so that if someone were to come to your website, they would be able to get exactly what they need for them to be able to hold people to account. So somewhere I want to sort of now end, because I also want time for discussion. That where do we go? How do we, what should be our interaction with this internet? It should be, to my mind, there are some of these which are considered labels, but they are very, very powerful concepts that we need to flesh out. What is the question of making informed choices? Because the whole business of information was actually an information within a democracy, is a question of making informed choices and informed decision making, where everyone gets access to that information. People can repackage that information the way they want, can represent that information, where the different forms, those who are governing and their information systems, can be juxtaposed, and where in a more equal platform there can be a face-off between what is used for control and what is used to fight control. Because these stories were all stories of people fighting for control over their own lives and fighting against others who were misusing information very effectively to control their lives. How can we move from this management information system to a true Janta information system, which will include the mic, it will include the hard copy, it will include the wall painting. A fantastic, Sanjay Sahni also, in between where he made a little bit of progress, is when he said, when they ran away with the records, then we told Santosh Mathew, he said, I can give them the internet records. I said, that Sanjay Sahni already has, and they're not believing it. So then we had worked out a means by which we said all this internet records, one very powerful way in which people can understand that information in their own communities is to paint on the walls a summary of what has been distributed to each person. So Sanjay Sahni and his family worked for 80 days and got 8,000 rupees. Gets painted on the wall, and like that 100 names get painted on the wall, and everyone knows everyone's name on that, and they say, "Arey Sanjay Sahni to does electricity work in Delhi, how can his name be here?" In one shot you can do a public audit, in one shot you can call that, actually it's like a web wall. Those who want to see it, see it. Those who don't want to see it, don't see it. Those who want to visit it, visit, but it's there, proactively disclosed. So within the right to information also, where we only talk about proactive disclosure on the web, we need to talk about these other modes where it's no point having the whole country's information there, but it's of extremely great importance to have information that they want for themselves. Their ration information, the Anganwadi information, the PDS information, the hospital information, the list of medicines, the stock register of medicines, those proactively disclosed so that this digital divide is not a divide but a bridge, where that digital thing helps you get the summary of information, helps you reach it quickly and effectively, but actually finally what people need is what they get in the form and format that they need and get. So I think what I'd like to say is that in using the same, there is not just the software, but there is also the hardware. And the hardware is not just the computer, but there's the hardware of the wall, there's the hardware of the parcha, there's the hardware of the mic, there's the hardware of information communication technology that needs to be used. And that's why in the age of the internet, the big fear is that we are going to just disappear into that computer. We are going to forget the extreme power of face-to-face interaction. There is no way, nothing on earth that can be done through the internet that equals what changes in the political dynamic when there is a Jansunwai. The Jansunwai takes place and the political dynamic changes. That cannot happen on the internet, no matter how many groups and subgroups and Facebook friends you have. It cannot change, and that is something that we need to understand. And we need to understand the potential of social media, but also the superficiality of it, because I have also now started getting involved and seeing it. And just this idea of just saying, I agree or I like, or and the difference, a very great difference in knowing what it takes to change something. That is something that we are tending to lose. And this idea that I can just press a button and therefore get involved is interesting, but is also very dangerous. And today we were talking with Prabir on the way here, there's also this danger of one person sitting on a computer seeming like a million people, and that person actually misrepresenting situations and scenarios and getting too much power because they can be overactive on the internet and keep seeming like much more. It's another kind of virtual unreality. So I want to end by saying that we need to do, what we need to do is, like in the RTI when people defined it, they changed it, and therefore actually Mr. Shankaran, a friend of Usha's and ours, he said one day, and it came to us, he said that, the real power of the RTI, the way it's been defined, is that it really has been used as a transformatory right. It has transformed all those issues of social justice that people took up and allowed them to transform the way in which information was used in that and transform the whole dynamic of that. We need to use the internet for people's issues in a transformatory fashion. And that can only be done when they start defining it. When the Sanjay Sahnis of the world, there are others, there's a woman called Norti who does fantastic things with the computer, who again has not been able to school. She's a sarpanch and she teaches computers to 8th standard girls. But she knows both what it is about it and its limitations, and what to take from it and where to interact it with the rest of her world. So I think the most important thing is that if we want to look for social justice in an internet-mediated world, we have to first mediate it through people. And therefore, we have to look at internet through a people-mediated world.